started my college career. I was actually recruited by the University of Coastal Carolina, and I was there on a track scholarship. I was actually receiving 40%, and I had to transfer schools because the track program was cut due to a Title IX issue. So all the athletes on scholarship lost their scholarships. So I was there, you know, not having to pay too much money for school. But when they cut the program, we also lost our scholarships. And especially being an out-of-state student, I would have been paying about $30,000 a year for school, when a lot of the kids down in South Carolina were paying like $7,000. So I actually wasn't able to stay because it was just way too expensive to stay. So I ended up coming up here for in-state tuition and continue my sports career.
I played soccer all 4 years of high school, and I ended up playing soccer this year.
I played 4 years of high school golf and basketball, and I eventually, my junior year, won the state championship for my Division III team.
So, along with the NCAA, I've also played for the NJCAA, and one of the first things that they do is they sit you down and they put you in a contract. And so that's one of the first things that all amateurism sports do, just so they can prevent the contracts of professional teams, and they don't want any salaries for participating athletes. They don't allow any prize money, even if it's like extracurricular activities. If I do a volleyball tournament on the weekend, I can't accept the $100 reward that is winning the whole tournament. Playing with professionals is considered illegal in the NCAA, and the tryouts, practices, or competition with any professional team is also not allowed. They don't allow any benefits from agents, so you can't be represented, even if you are looking to go into the like NFL or any sort of professional league after the fact. So I know a lot of the Division I schools and like the Big Ten schools get caught in these scandals for that. And then they delay initial full-time collegiate enrollment to participate in organized sports competitions.
And basically what that means for the delayed full-time enrollment is for a lot of athletes that participate in the Olympics especially, because if you look at the Olympics, you're playing with professionals from other countries, you're accepting gold medals, and the NCAA will kind of look away from that when you actually play. So a lot of these rules aren't super finite, and it's a lot of gray area for a lot of athletes participating at that higher level when it comes to the Olympics. I know when I was part of Coastal Carolina, we were also part of the United States Track and Field Association. So we would go to meets and actually compete against athletes like Tyson Gay, Lolo Jones, Ashton Eaton, and a lot of other professional athletes. And we were allowed to do that. Yes, we weren't allowed to accept the prize money or the new car that you got if you win. But the whole being able to compete with them, as you can see, is actually almost breaking a lot of those rules. So we would actually leave school early on Fridays to go to track meets for the entire weekend. So we would be leaving school for an offset time. Yes, we were still considered full-time students and everything because we were only missing one day. But I know I got a lot of leniency from teachers and school officials and stuff like that when it came to missing classes because of track and field or other sporting events.
So most of the NCAA revenue comes from media rights, which amounts to a total of $10.8 billion. Most of the remaining revenue comes from NCAA championships, mostly from ticket sales. And the University of Alabama reported an earning of $143.3 million in athletic revenues, which amounts to more than every NHL team and 25 of the 30 NBA teams. And the yearly earnings for all NCAA teams amounts to $771,428,571. And the top five earners for the Division I conference is SEC at first for $123 million, the Big Ten, which is $119 million, Big 12, $110 million, Pac 12, $107 million, and ACC, which is $84 million. And a lot of that revenue comes mostly from bowl games. And when you see all this money being made by these college teams, you start to question where that money is going to and why these athletes aren't being compensated. And although they are not professionals, they still have to balance a rigorous sports schedule with their school career, and that deserves some pay, especially since a lot of them aren't going to go to that professional level and won't make money for a living playing a sport.
football, 36,070, hockey, 31,756, track and field, 11,260, golf, 2,066, lacrosse, 12,303, and for women's ice hockey, which is 4,693, is the greatest amount you can get, guaranteed a full ride as a woman. And then gymnastics is 40,072, tennis is 32,630, equestrian is 10,462, lacrosse is 12,884, and track and field is 14,574.
Yeah, and so you will see the, I can call them for-profit sports, are the ones that receive the biggest scholarships, like basketball, football, and ice hockey for guys. Like, you'll see that on every Saturday morning. You know, I know where I work, we'll have like every single college football game going on at the same time. And basically what that leads to is they're using the player's likeness and everything for people basically to watch those sports. I mean, you're not going to have a lot of people watching college lacrosse or college track and field, except when it comes to around the Olympics time, where football, basketball, and hockey. With basketball, you have the March Madness tournament where everybody's entering pools and spending money to, you know, try to win money. I know Warren Buffett does the $1 billion if you get a perfect bracket in your March Madness tournament, and you're basically paying to enter that as well. So that's just more revenue accumulated, not through the school, but through private firms that are offering, you know, money and stuff to regular people to basically spend money on these athletes' likeness.
One of our examples is Donald De La Haye. He received a football scholarship to the University of Central Florida, and his scholarship was revoked because he was making YouTube videos that were football related. So the NCAA considered the YouTube account as a salary base.
Yeah, it was using his likeness as almost a professional athlete to gain money from it.
Explain to us, Donald, how this came to a head and you had to make this decision between playing football and creating your videos.
Well, as you may know, this all came to attention a couple months ago. And throughout this whole time, they've been going back and forth trying to decide what they would do. And in the end, they just told me I either agreed to the terms they gave me, which I didn't feel like were too fair, or, you know, I'd choose to rule myself ineligible. I really didn't agree to what they were telling me to do. I felt like it was unfair. I felt like, you know, it violated some of my principles and some of my values. So I went down the road of chasing my dream, man.
What was your reaction when you got that news that you were being ruled ineligible?
Man, my heart instantly sunk. I didn't think it was gonna, you know, come to something this huge. Like, my whole college education's at jeopardy now because of some YouTube videos. When I started making these videos, I didn't think that much was going to come of it. I thought I was going to, you know, inspire positivity and bring good things, but, man, my heart sunk when I got the news.
Okay, so there was a choice here, there. Why did you ultimately say, listen, I want to keep making these videos instead of kicking for the football team? What did it come down to for you, Donald?
Because some of the things they were offering just didn't seem too, you know, fair in my opinion. And basically the bread and butter of my channel is football related stuff. They told me I couldn't even, you know, go to the beach and toss a football with my friends. I couldn't even talk about quarterbacks, nothing. You know, I felt like it was extremely unfair in my opinion.
Now, as you mentioned, your college education is in a little bit of jeopardy, which begs the question, if you're giving up this D1 scholarship, how lucrative are these videos? Does it make financial sense for you to continue doing them?
I mean, it doesn't make financial sense, but it's something I truly believe in. I've always thought about, I mean, I live by a quote, 10 toes down, and that basically means, you know, you stand firm for what you believe in, and I've always stood firm about what I believe in, and of course, I don't make enough money on YouTube to continue with my education. That's why I raised the GoFundMe. You know, I'm trying to raise money to pay my tuition and continue to chase my passion, but, yeah, man, I wasn't making nowhere near enough to fund my education.
So a lot of these student athletes, even though they might be receiving a lot of money in scholarships, like you saw, like when Anna was telling about the ice hockey players who are making, you know, not really making, but they're given $41,000 to pay for school. A lot of the schools that they're going to cost about that much because not many programs offer women's hockey, especially at that high of a level. Like, I know the big schools for women's hockey or for hockey in general is actually actually RPI in New York, and then they have a couple other ones up north as well, like the University of Anchorage, the like Stanford, and the bigger schools like that will offer those full ride scholarships. But those scholarships only cover exactly what they entail when it comes to cost of school, cost of living, and stuff like that. You do receive some like meal allotments and stuff like that when you travel, but when it comes to earning a salary to basically pay for everyday expenses, they're not covered at all, especially with these athletes working so much for their sports. They're not really able to work at any other job. So another example of that is Ryan Trahan. He's actually a Texas A&M cross country runner. He's a freshman last year. And in high school, he started his own business with one of his friends called Neptune Bottles, which is like one of those steel reusable water bottle companies. And his revenues were around like $50,000 in the first couple of years of him being in high school. And then when he started getting scholarships and getting national attention from other schools and then officially decided to commit to the Texas A&M school, he was deemed ineligible to run for his first race because they were considering him using his likeness to help promote his brand of Neptune Bottles. So a quote from him is, "I don't understand how I'm allowed to have a job working at McDonald's or something while being an athlete, but I can't have a company that I'm passionate about." He said it just baffles me about the way NCAA runs things. And that kind of goes back to the NCAA gray areas when it comes to being a student athlete and receiving benefits or being sponsored through your own company. So he was actually deemed eligible to play, but what he basically had to do is he had to cut all ties with his business. So if you were to go to neptunesbottles.com and use their domain, that he has no affiliation with the brand anymore, basically. So he started this company, he was really passionate about it, he didn't want to give it up, but he used social media and Instagram to kind of promote his business, and it worked for him. But the NCAA and Texas A&M found this as a violation of his NCAA eligibility, so they actually told him to cut all ties. So if you were to go to their website, you wouldn't see his face at all in the name stat or anything like that. So it's actually, he still works for it, but it's more like a part-time job for him. So he's really only putting in 15 hours a week, where he's playing sports, he's putting in, you know, anywhere between 40 to 60 hours a week plus travel time when he's in season, especially with cross-country and track and field. Well, usually the cross-country runners are three-season athletes. So instead of them just working for one season, like the football players or the baseball players and the baseball players in the spring, track and field and cross-country is a bit more or less an all-year-round kind of thing, because he's going to be running cross-country and training in the fall, and then he's also going to be doing indoor track as well as outdoor track when it comes to the more competitive seasons. Wrong way. And another way that athletes will kind of try to make money through their likeness is they'll try to find and make money actually any other way they can. Like any other person, you're going to try to make money and survive by working a job. So a very memorable person that did this was Terrell Pryor. He's actually a Washington Redskin right now. He actually plays in the NFL. But for his time at the University of Ohio, or Ohio State University, he was their starting quarterback. He was actually one of like the leading reasons why Ohio State was so undefeated, like the undefeated through the 2015 and 2016 seasons. He's actually part of this called Tattoo Gate, where a couple players and himself were receiving illegal benefits from a tattoo parlor around the area. You can actually kind of see on his right forearm there throwing the ball, he's like covered in tattoos, and supposedly he was given those tattoos for selling memorabilia to the tattoo parlor. So actually his freshman year of school, he sold his game pants for $3,000, and that's kind of what started the whole tattoo gate, because when he sold his pants, just his game pants, like, you know, nothing really too special about them, but somebody wanted them for $3,000. That's a lot of money for a college student. That's a lot of ramen, you know? So a lot of athletes will be part of this. Like, it was him and five other athletes who got brought down for this, but Terrell Pryor was the main face of it. So he received illegal benefits, and actually when he went into the NFL, he was banned from associating or basically affiliating with Ohio State University for the next 5 years. So if you were to go to their website and stuff, it's actually really hard to find that picture, because Ohio State basically burned him from his books and wanted to basically get rid of him as, you know, an affiliate. So some of our arguments for paying athletes is it will incentivize them to stay for 4 years. There's a lot of programs, especially in the NCAA, especially for basketball, that kind of make kind of bank on student athletes going pro, like the University of Kentucky. Like, you'll always hear about them in the March Madness tournament. They're usually the number one seed. A lot of their athletes just go there for 1 year because the NBA actually forces at like basketball athletes to attend at least 1 year university before going to the league. That wasn't how it always was. Actually, LeBron James was one of the last athletes to go directly from high school into the NBA. But now they are forcing athletes to go at least 1 year for collegiate athletics before they can go pro. So a lot of the athletes will go for 1 year, and since they're not really making any money through it like they would if they would go pro, they just leave right after that 1 year. It happens a lot in football, basketball as well. Football, that usually lasts like 1 or 2 years because NCAA is a development for the NFL, but NFL teams don't really look at freshmen, especially when you have the size difference between the NFL linemen and the freshman like linemen for the NCAA. So another argument for paying is the ability to afford everyday expenses. Because going back to that statistic I was saying, where the scholarships might seem like a lot, but when it comes to all the time they're putting into their sport and everything else for them not to be able to get a job outside of the school, they can't really afford everyday expenses like a cell phone bill or pay for any outside expenses. Because I know I have to pay for my car, I have to pay for insurance, and it's really hard for me to do that if I'm spending 50, 60 hours a week playing sports and not being able to work a job as well at the same time. And if they do get paid, it will cut down on a lot of recruiting scandals, because a lot of the higher end teams like the University of Notre Dame, University of Miami, have actually been a part of big recruiting scandals that athletes and their families are receiving illegal benefits from the school to come to that school. A big one that was an issue a couple years ago was when Cam Newton was at Auburn. He was actually, the coaches from Auburn were paying his dad a salary of $100,000 to basically allow Cam Newton to go to the school. This wasn't found out until Cam Newton actually graduated, so there wasn't really any repercussions of it, but there's a lot of stuff that happens with, I know the University of Notre Dame right now has allegations of recruiting scandals, then they actually might not be allowed to recruit athletes for the next 4 years.
And so adding to what Jordan said, another argument is that they put their bodies on the line each game that they play, each practice they go to. They have a possibility of having a career-ending injury. This right here is Inky Johnson. He was a cornerback for the University of Tennessee, and he was projected to be top 30 draft pick in the NFL. And 8 games before the draft, he went in for a hit, and that left him almost dying. And now, as you can see, he doesn't have use of his right arm, so that impacted him for the rest of his life, just playing and making money for like the school. Another case was Devon Walker at Tulane University. He broke his neck, and he's still having trouble gaining like even just like the lightest touch on things. Another thing is that these college players don't only benefit revenue-wise, they benefit with applications and enrollment from incoming freshmen. In 2012, the UCLA had a survey with their incoming freshmen, and the survey showed that 40% of them went to UCLA because of their athletic social life, like their football team brings with their games or their basketball team brings. Studied by Bloomberg, these three universities and colleges had an application spike after their success in the March Madness. The Florida Gulf Coast made it to the Sweet 16 in 2013, and 27.5, their application rate rose by 27.5%. Lehigh University upset Duke University in 2012, and that rose their application. And lastly, Wichita State made it to the Final Four in 2013, and their application rose by 30%. And just on my reason to come here, like, I came for soccer. I left Roger Williams just for athletics, so that's just one person. Many people can probably go to different schools for their athletics.
Yeah, no, actually, when Coastal won the World Series for the College World Series for baseball, they actually got a really lucrative deal with Under Armour and were receiving gear and everything like that, but that was all through the school, so it was completely illegal. But I know a lot of student athletes and recruiting went up in that right after they got that sponsorship from Under Armour, because first of all, with them winning the College World Series, it shows that their program is So that just in the time that they've won the College World Series, they've built a brand new sports facility. Like, they actually increased their capacity in their football stadium by at least 20,000, and they're actually one of the only teams in the United States to have a teal field, because that's actually their colors. So that's pretty cool, besides like Boise State and a couple other schools that have like customized fields.
And I'm sure we can all relate to this, whether you play sport in college or just class time. It's hard to work a schedule around classes, jobs, but these student athletes have to work around practices, games, and like lifting condition sessions with school, never mind if they have a job, so it's just tough.
Yeah, so as well, another one of our ideas to kind of help pay student athletes if they were to receive benefits and stuff, were to kind of treat student athletes as like a work study program. So basically the time that they put into their sport would be considered like an hourly wage, depending on what's like where their school is from and what their state minimum wage is. So that instead of just, you know, putting 40, 50 hours and putting all this time into the sport and getting nothing back from it, they actually receive like a small salary so they can use that for every